Good evening. Welcome to our Maundy Thursday service. I'm so glad you're here. If you're joining us online, thank you for being here tonight. As we begin, I invite you to join me in the greeting. The words will be on the screen or they're in your bulletin. A table is set before us. The feast is prepared for us.
A meal of bread and wine, of meat and better herbs.
The Lord calls us to the supper of remembrance. The Lord calls us to serve and be served. As we break the bread and share the cup, our understanding may fail us, but we will never forget Christ's example. We will never forget the full extent of his love. And let us pray. O holy God, remind us on this special day of the many ways we know you as a strong deliverer, as a humble servant, as the one who bids us to love one another, that the world might know you. Lead us not only to the beauty of solitary reflection, but also to community, as we remember together your words and your example. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. I invite you to join us as we sing our opening hymn, 292, What Wondrous Love Is This? Gospel lesson for tonight comes from John 13, 1 through 17, and then 31b through 35. It's now before the festival of the Passover. Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas of Simon Iscariot to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, he got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." And Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who is bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and had returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite you to join me in an invitation to communion. The words will be on the screen here. On the night of his arrest, Jesus took the bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Remember me."
As Jesus gave thanks to God, we also give thanks for his sacrifice. The
bread broken for you. On that same night, in the same way, the Lord took the cup, saying, "This is my blood poured out for you. Remember me."
Jesus gave thanks to God. We also thanks for this new covenant.
When you eat this bread and you drink this cup, remember the Lord Jesus. Remember and be thankful. Remember until he comes. Remember us when you come, Lord Jesus. Thanks be to God. I invite the praise team, our singers, to come on down, and we'll get you a cracker and a juice, and then we'll invite others to come as we sing. Stay there. Julie. Body broken for you and his blood shed for you. Kristen, the body broken for you and the blood shed for you. Mike, the body broken for you and the blood shed for you. Jeff, the body broken for you and the blood shed for you. Amen. As we continue, we'll sing 618 together. Let us break bread together. As we sing and as you feel led, we invite you to come forward for the bread and for the juice. The bread broken for you. Lord God, we give you thanks for the gifts that we celebrate as a community. We're thankful for the gift that it is to each of us, the gift that it is to the world. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Now I invite you to stand as you're able for a moment as we pass the peace, as we shake hands and wish each other God's love. As we do not have kids here, we'll continue on past that. The sermon for tonight is called, Do You Know What I Have Done? As we begin this time together, just a question or two for you to think about. What's the worst job you ever had to do? What's the worst job you ever had to do? Was it cleaning the outhouse? Was it scrubbing out an old dirty garbage can? Was it changing somebody else's bandages? Was it something else? When I was about 24 years old, I took a job at a 4-H farm in Bloomington, Connecticut. I was working on my master's degree in elementary education, and I took this position as an education director. Groups would come out to the farm, mostly homeschool groups, but once in a while it was a school group. And we'd learn about the processes of growing food, of raising animals, of feeding pigs, and so on. I really liked the job. The kids would come, and we'd start off with a hayride up to the apple orchard, where we would pick apples, and we'd bring them back down to the barn, and we'd put them in this big press that they had, and we'd crank the handle, and out would come fresh apple cider that the kids would get to drink. And then we'd walk around to the backside of the education building, and I'd explain how the composting toilets worked and how they were so good for our environment. I would show them how to milk a cow with the machine, of course. And then we'd take that milk and we'd pour it in a big pan that the pigs would just slop up. It was a fun job. The kids always enjoyed being there so much. And then there'd be days when there wasn't a group coming, which was okay. On those days, I would work with Tim, who was the hired hand. Some days, we'd go out to the raspberry patch, and we'd have to pull out the suckers. And then we'd have to tuck in the remaining vines inside these guide wires. Some days we just have to mow. Other days we'd help John, who was the farm manager, baling and stacking the hay. Now, by I mean help, I mean John would drive the tractor, and Tim and I would be on the back. We'd stack the bales on the wagon, and then John would drive into the barn, and we'd stack them in the hayloft. Well, the time finally did come when there were several days in a row where we didn't have a group coming. John decided that that was the time we needed to clean out the cow stall that the cows used all winter long. Connecticut winters are long. No exaggeration, at the back of the pen, which was probably about this size, the manure was about 2 feet deep. And as you got to the front, which was probably about where Tom was, it got down to about a foot. Just say the job was not tackled in quite a long time by the time Tim and I got to it. And we learned as we pulled the skid steer up that the skid steer would not fit through the door to the stall. So, our job was to get some pitchforks, one scoop at a time, to scoop up this mix of old hay and urine and manure and put it out in the bucket. And we'd fill up the bucket and go dump the bucket and on. Now, we were smart enough to start at the entrance to the stall. There was still a little fresh air there. But on day three, as we were getting towards the back of the stall, we realized that the fresh air was not very prevalent at that spot. But we kept working, and eventually we cleaned out the stall. 3.5 days later, we were done. That, my friends, is the worst, grossest, most disgusting job I have ever done in my life. Now, as we prepare to look at kind of a similar job that Jesus undertook, let us pray. Lord God, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts acceptable in your sight, O Lord. You are our rock and our redeemer. If you have a Bible here, if you have one at home, I invite you to turn with me to John 13, where our passage for tonight comes from. John's gospel is really the only one of the three, four, that does not depict in detail the Last Supper. In chapter 6, he kind of alludes to it a little bit, talks about the bread and the blood, but not in a setting like Matthew, Mark, or Luke do, where they gather in the upper room and they go through all the words. Overall, John has a completely different agenda than the other three gospel writers. So instead of focusing or at least giving some attention to this institution of communion, he spends time on this odd little event, this neglect of hospitality, this detail that was overlooked by those planning the party. Jesus sets for the disciples and for us an example of how we are to live out our faith. He washes the disciples' feet. In verses 4 and 5, we read about how Jesus, he got up from the table. He took off his outer robe and he wrapped a towel around his waist and he got a basin. And he began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them dry with the towel around his waist. Part of me couldn't help but wonder, what was Jesus, what was going through his mind as he got up and headed over toward the basin, as he got undressed and wrapped that towel around his waist? Was it a light bulb moment? Like, maybe if I finally show them what I mean by all these things I've saying, maybe then they'll get it? Or was it just another opportunity to be these words that he spoke so often? Or was it just a matter of course for Jesus? He saw a need, he got up to fill it, not thinking for a moment about how they would respond to such an act as this. In the minds of the disciples, this was something demeaning. This task that Jesus took on, kneeling, serving in this humble way, that's probably why they all overlooked it at the beginning of the time together. To each of the disciples, it was a demeaning task. It was far below them. Jesus didn't see it as demeaning. He saw that as an opportunity for him to serve others. Afterwards, he says, "Do you know what I have done? Do you know what I've done for you?" As he stared out at his disciples, he got the usual, I think, blank stares and open mouths. That's what Jesus saw when he asked, "Do you know what I've done?" In Luke's gospel, he follows this up in the upper room story with the disciples arguing about who's the greatest. Clearly, they did not get what Jesus had done. They were still looking for the best seats to be the number one disciple. They were still looking for a reward. They didn't know what he had done. They didn't know him because they didn't know what he did. Sometimes I envy the disciples a little bit. Maybe you do too. Sometimes I look at the disciples and say, they got to spend 3 years with Jesus. How awesome that must have been to walk and talk and sleep and just live with Jesus for 3 years. But they still don't get it at times when they should. They just don't. So they really don't have an advantage over us in a lot of ways, I don't think. But if we hear this story tonight and we walk away without really appreciating what Jesus did, if we don't take this example to heart, then we're like the disciples. We don't quite know this Jesus. Well, as Jesus returns to the table, he explains how important his actions are. He says, yes, you call me Lord and teacher, and that's right. That's who I am. We all have titles, don't we? Mine's father, husband, pastor, a few of mine. And I could come to work tomorrow, and I could see a mess out front there, and I could call Barb and say, Barb, you need to get down here and clean up this mess. Or I could go home from church Sunday this and getting ready for our trip to see our son and daughter-in-law, and I could just put my feet up and say, Kristen, why don't you get the car packed? I could say, Sam, Abby, go get some gas in the car. We need our car ready for the trip. We could exercise authority over others. We can exercise power, can't we? I could take the small tasks and say, they're below me. That's not something I would do. And Jesus could have done that too this night. He could have looked across the table and said, Nathaniel or Bartholomew, go get the basin, go get the towel, wash our feet, go. And they'd have gone. They'd have walked over to the basin. They'd have come back with the towels. They'd have done that just like Tim and I did that day when we walked out to that barn full of cow manure. They'd have done it, though. But Jesus doesn't do any of that. None of that. He doesn't use his authority to command others to do this or that. He dons a servant attitude, and Jesus washes feet. And then in verse 6, he gets around to Simon Peter partway through the circle of disciples. And Simon Peter struggles with one who he sees as above him, stooping down to wash his feet. Jesus says, unless I wash you, you have no share in me. Continuing to demonstrate a lack of understanding, Peter goes on. Says, well, not only my feet, but my hands and my head too. If the washing of his feet connected him to Jesus, Peter's saying, well, give me more, Jesus. If a little water on my feet's good, give me some water on my hands and on my head. I want more of you. Jesus moves on, leaving Peter there at the place at the table, and he finishes. And we pick up again here in verse 14. And Jesus instructs them. He says, so, if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to do as I have done for you. Jesus is saying, if I can do this for you, if I, your Lord and teacher, can do this, then you can do it. You can do it for each other. As he continues on, he drives the point home even farther as he quotes a very well-known proverb of the day. He says, very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master. In the culture of the day, that proverb meant that the disciples would model what they saw their master doing. It would be seen in their lives, whatever the master did in his life. The disciples would hear a clear invitation from Jesus, their master, to do as he did, as the servants should do. And he adds even more emphasis in verse 17. In verse 17, he says, if you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. If you have seen my example, disciples, if you know the proverb, if you do these things, then you will be blessed. You will be blessed. Later on in the second half of the passage in verse 34, Jesus says, I give you a new commandment that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. Except this commandment was not new. Not really. It connects to the Old Testament, to Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. It was a well-known, deeply rooted truth of the Jewish faith, to love one another. In the context of Leviticus, though, it was to counter our tendency to be revengeful, to hold grudges. That's the line that precedes, you should love one another, in Leviticus. It was a reactive verse. Don't hold a grudge. Don't get revenge. Love instead. Instead, Jesus chooses to make it proactive. As I wrote about this morning in my blog, he says this is something we should do actively rather than reactively. That is why we acted it out in front of others. That's why he chose to wash the disciples' feet, to be active in his faith, by serving, by getting on his knees, by bending down to a task that even those fishermen in the group thought was beneath them. Jesus showed them what it meant to love as I have loved you. Love like I love you, he says to his followers. Not for the disciples. The command wasn't supposed to be like, once a year when we get together to celebrate the Passover, wash each other's feet. It wasn't supposed to be just this sporadically practiced thing. It was supposed to be a way of life for the disciples. There's a willingness to serve that comes in this command. The Maundy of Maundy Thursday literally translates to the word command. This is the command Thursday. Jesus commands the disciples to love each other as he loved them. Not just one Thursday a year, not just every third Monday of the month, but every day. Each day, whenever opportunity comes, Jesus asks the disciples this question, but he also asks us, do you know what I have done? Do we know what Jesus did in washing feet? To get to the essence of that question, we really have to think about what does it mean? What does it mean to love one another? There's a lot of ways to answer that. To me, it means that you're able to work for the good of the other. It means that you're thinking of the good of the one that you're supposed to love all the time. And you hold the other in your heart and in your mind as you live and as you work each day. We're not just to do that for our own good, but we're to live and work for the good of others. We're to look for ways to serve each other. And sometimes we're even to seek opportunities, to create opportunities to serve one another. Doing these things, I believe we are blessed. Now, choosing to be a humble servant, choosing to love the other, it doesn't always feel like a blessing, does it? That's part of the risk. Sometimes it doesn't turn out like we hope. That thing we tried to do for somebody backfires. Sometimes it isn't received as we intended it to be received. And our inclination is to say, okay, I'm going to stop. I'm going to quit doing this. I'm going to quit trying to serve others rather than to get it wrong. In those instances, we invite you to trust God, to believe the good will come from your efforts if it's truly humble service. Because I believe God has a way of working things out. He really does. So this command, love one another as I have loved you, it's not just a good idea. It's not just a clue to living better. It's not just a suggestion for our health or our happiness. Jesus made it a command. He said, love one another. For those within the church, and especially for those outside of the church, it's a sign that we belong to Christ, that we are part of a Christian fellowship, that we're part of the family. Belonging to Christ and to this community, it's shown not by how many Bible passages we read. It's not shown by the acts of charity that we perform. It's not shown by the hours we spend sitting in these green chairs. Those are all good. But the sign is something else entirely, the sign that says we belong. It's in the last verse. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. It's not about what's in here, but it's what comes out. It's about what shows. How are we showing our love for one another? That's the question for us. It's not easy. Loving takes time. It takes sacrifice. It takes effort. Yet what he said was, love as I have loved you. Here's where we come back to being gathered up in Jesus, the theme for this worship series. On our own, on my own, Loving like he loved is beyond me. It's outside of my ability. But when we let his love begin to work in us, through us, it becomes possible, at least the small step at a time. So as we close, I invite you to consider what "as I have loved you" means to you. At the beginning, we posed some questions. Had you think a little bit? Sometimes we think our greatest sin was just too great. Our worst failure of faith was so bad. Sometimes we do something that's cruel or evil. But Jesus' response to all those things, no matter what they are, is a demonstration of his love for us. No matter what we've done, no matter what we failed to do, Jesus washes all that away, just like he washed the dirt off the disciples' feet. He does it with love, with compassion, with grace, and with ease. What depth of love Christ has for you and for me. May we go this night and this week and do as Jesus has done for us, seeking to love well. Amen. Amen. As we continue, I invite you to join me in an attitude of prayer as I share a prayer of thanksgiving. We'll close with the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Oh, loving Christ, on that night so long ago, you knew that your hour had come. You knew full well what lay ahead of you. Your disciples loved you and followed you, but they also failed you. They would fail you yet again that night. One would betray you. Yet you washed their feet, as a servant would, even the feet of your betrayer. We have also loved you and followed you. We have also failed you. We cannot comprehend the love that you show us, the love that is our example, the love that tells us to do as you have done for us. May we seek to be like you, Master, a servant of all. May we see how we long to be your faithful disciples. May all see how we love each other, just as you have loved us. And Lord, you hear our voices and our prayers. God, you desire to loosen our bonds. I know that when we fall short, you still hear our prayer. And you want to free us to live lives of gratitude and service. In that spirit, in this moment of quiet, Lord, I ask that you would hear each of us as we share the joys and concerns of our hearts. In this moment of quiet, Lord, hear us as we pray. Thank you, Lord, for hearing each of those prayers. It's in your holy name that we now join our voices as one as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught, as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our closing hymn, Jesu, Jesu.
Show us how to serve and
Thank you for joining us tonight. If you joined us online, thank you. Now may we receive the blessing with dismissals. How precious to the Lord is the death of his faithful. How precious is the sacrifice of Christ to us. You are his treasure for which everything was given. Know that you are precious to God. And know that you are worthy of Christ's sacrifice. May we go in peace this evening to serve and love the Lord. Amen, amen. And amen.